I guess the growth in his brain or something.
Brain tumor.
Yeah, but so we'll they're at least those three are on our list, and we'll definitely be praying for them. So you might add them to your own lists also. I started recording, so we're getting back into the lesson. We'll go ahead and get started. One of the things we've been talking about as we were completing chapter 5 is we've been talking about, well, let me just go ahead and share the screen out. We've been talking, as you can see, the ministry of reconciliation. We were talking about coming to Christ, what it is, who we are, and what our relationship with the Lord is, and coming into reconciliation with Christ. In other words, bringing our lives into a life relationship with Jesus, and then building on that relationship daily. Now, if you don't, guess what? You're going to end up going back to what your natural person feels comfortable doing. And regrettably, in the flesh, our flesh is cursed, and it is drawn to this world. If the love of the world is in us, we can't have the love of God in us too, okay? Because they are antithetical one to another. So do we have to live in the world? Yes. Do we have to rely on those attributes from the world? Yes. But our relationship and our building of who we are in character and everything should be from Christ. And that's where our reconciliation is coming into that relationship with Christ and building on that relationship so that in this world, we display a whole different character than what the world is used to. And also, they know us as different from other people in the world because they will know us by our love. The love that Christ has shown to us is the same kind of love that we reflect to the world. And that's what we're called to do. And so as children of God and co-heirs with Jesus Christ, guess what? We're ambassadors for Christ, as he said in verse 20 of chapter 5. And we know that God makes his appeal through us. That means we are the ones that bring that ministry to others. His appeal is through us. In other words, some people say, well, if God wanted those people to be saved, why didn't he just take care of it? As a matter of fact, there were some called the ultra Calvinists from the back in the 1700s, 1800s, that they wouldn't even go witness to anybody because they'd say, well, if those people are already elect and chosen by God, why do we have to get involved to actually go tell them the good news? God will take care of it. Well, right here, this, what Paul is telling the Corinthians here is God makes his appeal through us. In other words, when we go out and witness to people, God is using us as his instrument to get that message out to others. And that's what Paul was doing for the Corinthians too. He was telling them, I have presented that gospel, that good news, that message to you as well. So we basically plead on Christ's behalf to be reconciled to God. We, when we tell others about the good news, we're asked, come on, people, you know, what does this world have to offer? Does it give you anything? Does it provide anything? No, it doesn't. So we then, the Holy Spirit, through us, works in that person's heart too. And as the Father draws them, then that person has a desire and a want to follow Christ. If they're one of the chosen and the elect, they will come. They will follow Christ through your message, my message, our message that we present to them. So then chapter 5 pretty much wraps up there. And so Paul jumps into chapter 6 and talks about that we work together with him. So in other words, a lot of times people tend to say, yeah, but you know, Jesus can do all he wants. He's God and he's got the power of God. But why do I have to get involved? Okay. Well, it's because we have a relationship with Jesus Christ. He is the head of the church. We are the body, and so we join him in his work. And as the body, we need to be the hands and feet and everything else, not separate from the body, but united into the body, because that's what makes the body a whole, okay? So, and I think that's the big problem we have in the church today, as I've said before. We have a bunch of Christians in the church body, but we don't have them united. So we've got like a hand over here, a baby finger over there, you know, an ankle over there. And that's problematic because it's not addressing what it is that God wants us, you know, to be able to say, okay? Yeah, I'm going to pray. So I think somebody said pray. But I mean, these are things that we have to be focused on if we're going to follow Christ, right? So that's why Paul is saying, we also appeal to you. Don't receive the grace of God in vain. Everything that we have is by God's grace. Okay, when we came into a relationship with Jesus Christ, from that moment forward, from the time that the Holy Spirit came to indwell us and we received that free gift of salvation, guess what? Everything that happens in and through us happens by God's grace. We don't deserve any of it. So if you think that somehow you're going to say, yeah, but I'm going to be a better Christian than, or if I say this to Andy, I'm going to be a better Christian than you. You know, the issue is, if I made a statement like that, what I'm saying is, hey, it's about my works, what I can do that somehow is going to make me better than Andy as a better Christian. And see, I can never say that. As a Christian, I can't say that because that's it. None of my Christianity is about me, is about works, is about my ego. It's all about what Christ did on the cross. And that means it all happened because of grace. So as I grow in him, I don't become better than another brother or sister. I just might have a closer relationship with Jesus Christ. But if anything, that should make me more humble, not more proud. See the issue? Because that's what Christ calls us to, is a life of humility in him, not a life of pride, not a life of arrogance, but of selflessness. And I'll tell you, that's not easy in our world and culture today, because our culture all says, hey, look out for number one. You know, don't let anyone walk over you. You know, you make sure that if they try to do you, you do them back double. You know, it's that kind of philosophy that our culture presents, and that's not what we're called to. So when we walk with Christ and we develop a closer relationship with him every day, you will find that the fruit of the Spirit will manifest itself in greater quantities in our life. And we will then produce that fruit that Jesus talks about in John 14 and 15. You know, we will bear much fruit. And it's not because somehow I'm better than another Christian. It just means I have a closer relationship with Jesus in the sense that I am more surrendered to him. And so because of that, he can use me more. He uses us in the capacity that we've surrendered to him to be able to be used. Okay? If you try to say, I'm going to be used the way I want to be used, and I'm going to be a Billy Graham, well, that's not God's plan for you. God's plan for Billy Graham was for Billy Graham. God's plan for Ted Russell is for Ted Russell. God's plan for Andy is for Andy. You see what I'm saying? I mean, so to try to compare myself to another Christian is not right. As a matter of fact, Paul even makes that statement later on in 2 Corinthians. We'll get to that. But we do have those. And see, the church at Corinth was prideful in many ways. They thought, hey, look at me, man. I'm better than so-and-so. If you remember when we were in 1 Corinthians, remember how some of them said, I follow Paul, or I follow Apollos, or I follow Cephas. Well, that's because they were prideful. They thought, hey, I'm a better Christian if I follow Peter, because he was an apostle that walked with Jesus. See the problem? That's not what Christ has called us to. He's called us to follow him. Not ourselves, not our pride, not our egoism. It all is surrendered to him, and we follow him. So, and all of that happens because of grace, okay? So it's not a vain thing to receive God's grace, but it's his gift to us. And in our daily walk with him and getting to know Christ better, he showers more grace on us. As we humbly surrender to him more and more each day and exalt him, he gives us more grace, okay? And what is grace? Grace is, you know, that unmerited favor. It's something we don't deserve, yet God gives it to us because he loves us and he wants us to be more like Christ, because that's what it says in Romans 8, that he wants us to be conformed to the image of his son. So if he wants us to be conformed to the image of the son, he wants us to look more and more like Jesus every day. So then it's going to go into talking about, you know, the Old Testament, and he's given some examples here of what it is that's being brought out. But before we get into that part, let's go ahead and pray and start going. I wanted to get that first part, that first verse out of the way, because it was tied in to the end of chapter 5. So let's go ahead and pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you that you're here with us this evening. And we want to exalt you and to honor you and to be humbled and surrendered before you, to be who you would have us be, and that we would be surrendered to your call and to join you in your work, that we would all carry out the will of the Father in reaching others, loving others, caring for others, and being selfless and sacrificial toward others, so that we can show your love to a world that is so, you know, just messed up with being selfish and arrogant and prideful and, you know, just seeking what it is that they can gain. And so we need to show a different love, a different way of reflecting you, because, I mean, it's your love and your truth that matter in this world today. It's not anything that we can somehow try to concoct in and of ourselves. There's no words that we can do that in any way will meet anyone's need out there. Only your loving grace is what can meet the need of a sinner that's out there today. And because, hey, we all sin, but it's only by your grace that we are forgiven. So we thank you for that, Lord Jesus. Now I pray, Holy Spirit, that you would open our eyes and our minds and our hearts to hear what you have to tell us today, and how Paul was presenting this to the Corinthians and how it applies to us in retrospect. We ask that you open up, you know, this special scripture for your honor and glory. We thank you for providing it, and we love you. In Jesus' name, amen. So now, that's a pretty heavy piece of actual advice that Paul is presenting to the Corinthians. And actually, he's presenting it to us today, because we all fall into that same mold today. And so then he says, he's going back to the Old Testament, and he's, you know, and so that was in Isaiah 49, that he says, at an acceptable time, I listened to you, and in the day of salvation, I helped you. So in other words, the Lord is the one that did the heavy lifting for us, didn't he? I mean, he died on the cross. It's not anything that we did that somehow puts us in a better position than anybody else. It's all by grace. And I think a lot of times, you know, I say this, and I've said it before, we don't speak enough about grace in the church today. We may mention it kind of like, yeah, we have grace, you know, through Christ. But I mean, what really is grace? I mean, grace is everything that God does in and through those who have come to him. Okay. So everything that happens and you're in my life, as we follow Christ, as we get to know him better, and when he does work through us, whether it's even through the Holy Spirit, all that is grace being showered on us, because, hey, we're fallen people. We're sinful people. You know, it's not by our works, and we can't boast about anything we do. It's all about what he has done. And when you reflect on that, that is all grace. We don't deserve any of it. But look at the hope we have, though, in trusting God. And, you know, Paul talks about in that day of salvation, I helped you. I mean, yes, he did. I mean, that was incredible help, right? Because, I mean, we couldn't do it on our own. So he helped us by giving us his grace. And that's why we have salvation today. But the hope is, look at what we have coming. We get to go be with the Lord Jesus Christ forever and ever, you know, in heaven with him. Now that, if that isn't grace, I don't know what is. Because guess where we were gonna go? if we had not accepted, you know, that free gift of salvation, that grace that he showered on us. Not a place that, you know, I think anyone would want to go say, hey, I want to put me up a condo down there. You know what I'm saying? It's just not there. It's not something we want, right?
So I mean, would burn down.
It'd have to be serious asbestos or something. But anyway, and then you get cancer. So I don't know. Anyway, but but look at what Paul's conviction is and what his challenge to them is. See, now is the acceptable time. Now is the day of salvation. Not tomorrow. You know, it's now. If I'm telling you about Jesus Christ right now, and for those who have gone out and witnessed before and talked to people, how many times have you heard somebody tell you, well, I still need to get myself right. I'm not good enough yet. Or I'm working on it. I'll get there. Or, you know, it's, and I think that Paul was experiencing something similar with some of those people that were attending the church, that they were saying, well, yeah, I like your message, Paul. It's a good message, you know, but, you know, I'm just not there yet. You know, I'll be there. Just give me time. I'll be there. And, you know, a lot of times we answer them because we feel a conviction for these people at some level. We say, yeah, but what if you get hit by a car tomorrow? I mean, not to be, you know, morbid, but the reality is we don't know what tomorrow will bring. We don't even know what the next hour will bring, right? And so the issue is, that's what he's talking about. Paul's saying, hey, I'm telling you right now is the time. Now is that time to turn your life over to Christ and accept his free gift of grace, which is salvation. And so that's why he's convicted. And as he's wrapping up this topic on reconciliation, he's saying, look, you know, you can do all you want to do in and of your own strength, but that's not where the answer is. The answer is in salvation through Jesus Christ by his gift of grace. And that's it. You know, it's by grace that we receive salvation. For by grace you have been saved through faith, right? It's the grace that gives us that faith to receive that gift of salvation that we didn't work for, not by works, so that no one can boast, right? And so I think in this second letter, Paul is being more tempered in the way he's addressing some of the issues that are still inherent within the church at Corinth. But he's trying to say, come on, guys, now you need to get on the bandwagon. You know, you've seen what, you know, God can do and has done already with the believers in this body. Those of you who haven't gotten on the bandwagon yet, now you need to now turn your lives over to him and stop, you know, making excuses as to why this just isn't the right time yet. You know, I'm coming, I'm getting there, but this isn't the right time. And we see a lot of that even in our culture today. I mean, I know I've been out, you know, like with Donna witnessing. And we get that answer, you know, with some of the people, you know, well, I'm working on it. I'm just not good enough yet. You know, one of these days, you know, or some just make the excuse, well, I just don't want to give up these things in the world yet. You know, I still want to live this kind of life, but eventually I'm sure I'll get there. You see the issue? I mean, if you procrastinate, you know what the Bible talks about, that your heart gets hardened. The more you put off God, you know, if he's calling you, the more your heart gets hardened. Those are difficult things. Paul told that to the Romans, you know, in his first chapter. So we see what this message of reconciliation is. It's about bringing the good news. It's about bringing people to Christ. But it's not going to be, you know, everybody's going to just jump at it and say, yes, I want to go to heaven. I want to be with Christ. And I want a strong relationship with Jesus Christ. You know, you would say, why not? But it's amazing all the excuses that people bring up these days. And I'm sure Paul was hearing a lot of them back then. And I'm sure mm-hmm. it frustrated him.
What is that scripture that says only the Holy Spirit can, no one can get saved unless the Holy Spirit, it's somewhere, one of the Gospels, I think.
Yeah, it says that the Father draws the person, And it's the Holy Spirit that does the work. You know, he's the one that changes the heart, but he works on both sides, doesn't he, Donna? He works on the side of the person that is witnessing, and the Holy Spirit works within the person that's receiving. But it's right. The Father that's drawing, you know. So, I mean.
But the God of this world has them blinded.
Oh, absolutely. Isn't that what Satan is?
Only God can lift that veil. That's what I was thinking that it was when it said only the Holy Spirit can draw them. Only God lifts the veil. And, you know, you present the gospel to people and they say, no, thank you. And I'm like, what?
Yep.
You know, but, you know, you can't beat it into their head or anything like that, which would be nice if you could, but you can't. So.
Exactly. Yeah.
Pray for them and let God do it, you know.
Amen. Amen.
I got volume, guys. Can you hear me?
Hey, Victor's on. Yay. Yo. Did the nurse help you?
Yeah.
She healed your phone?
Yeah. I'm sitting here in the bed yet, fixing to go home tomorrow, so.
Oh, okay. How you feeling? Yeah.
Thank you. I'm feeling great.
Good.
You sound great.
I came in here Sunday night. I called 911. I was going to drive myself, but I was bleeding all over the place.
Oh, man.
So they got me in the ambulance and took me over here.
So what did they say is happening? Why it keeps bleeding? Do they know?
Well, they went in there and they found a blood clot.
Kept
blocking up the catheter. Had trouble getting it. They couldn't get it free because the clots were so big.
Oh, my. A
tiny tip on the syringe.
Right.
Kept plugging it up. Anyways, I went down 6:30 last night for operation. He went in there and he found blood clot. He took it off, sent it in for culture or whatever you call that, biopsy.
Yeah.
And he catheterized the spot where it was coming out. So.
Oh, carterized.
Carterized. Yeah.
Yeah.
We're not medical people, so.
Yeah.
your sister is so.
Yeah.
So I haven't seen, oh crap, bleeding all over the place. She just took a IV out of my arm.
No.
So gotta call her. So I'm here in bed and I'm fixing to go home tomorrow.
Oh, praise the Lord.
So I'm hoping all is well.
Amen. Amen to that.
We're gonna agree according to Matthew 18:19 that you're all well.
Amen.
So I didn't mean to interrupt your class, but
no. Hey, brother, we're glad, you know. Man, praise the Lord.
Yeah.
Okay, so, go ahead.
Got to call her to get this blood stopped.
Yeah,
you're bleeding out of all ends.
Yeah. I'm gonna put you on mute, so
that's fine.
I'll still be hearing you.
Okie doke, my brother. Hey, great to see you too.
I can see you now.
I hear from you.
I hear your record sign.
Thanks for all your prayers.
Amen.
Yeah, I heard Margaret had the record sign.
Yep, she did. Hey, she's following up. Amen.
All right.
Okay.
I'll be watching, but I'm going to mute you.
You got it, brother.
Okay. Bye.
Okay, so now we want to look at where Paul's going, you know, now with his discussion with them, okay, in his letter. And he goes into verse 3, and I think he's trying to give them a perspective on the ministry he's been presenting to them, okay? And so he's saying, we are not giving anyone an occasion for offense, so that the ministry will not be blamed. In other words, he's saying, look, we came to give you the good news. And we have brought the message of Jesus Christ to you. And that's a great thing. It's salvation. It is eternal. And, you know, it's the entree to being with Christ. Okay. So he's saying, look, I'm not trying to offend. I'm not bringing, something that requires, you know, you to be offended by what I'm saying. Now, can the gospel offend certain people? Absolutely. The gospel can offend. Okay. Because, I mean, it is God's word. And if it's somebody that has not been drawn by the Father or by the Holy Spirit, they're probably going to get offended by what it is that they bring. But now the question is, why would Christians be offended by what it is that Paul is trying to do?
Could it be conviction, that the Lord's convicting them that they weren't doing right?
Maybe.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, think about it. I mean, we're all human beings, right? And if pride is in you, and somehow whatever Paul's presenting is not meshing up with what your pride is, wouldn't you take offense? Or wouldn't you take offense also if you thought that Paul wasn't the best guy to be presenting the message to you? Maybe you think Apollos would have been better, or maybe Peter would have been better. And so wouldn't you automatically feel like, you know, you're being shunned, so to speak, because you're not getting it from the best source? You know, but see, the message isn't about a message from who's providing it. It's about the good news of Jesus Christ, regardless of who's giving it to you. And so you can see that the Corinthians are still having issues taking offense to what Paul is doing, right? But see, Paul is determined. And he says, you know, I'm not trying to give you an occasion for offense. I just want to make sure that it's that the ministry is not being blamed. In other words, that what we are providing to you isn't somehow being looked at in a negative fashion. Okay? It's because it is the message of Christ. It is the message of salvation. And that's what, you know, you need to be able to call into your lives today, is now is the acceptable time for salvation. So think about those people that still haven't accepted Christ yet. Those are the ones that I'm pretty sure that Paul is talking to with this message here, okay? And so he's saying, instead, as God's ministers, in other words, Paul's there representing God, right? And that's what anyone that's in Christ should be doing. Shouldn't all of us be representing God and representing him and the good news that we provide to others? Sure. Will it be received by everybody? No. But for those that are going to receive it, hey, now is the day, right? You shouldn't put it off. And so he's saying, instead, as God's ministers, we commend ourselves in everything, okay? So as God's ministers, bringing the good news to the people, that's a good thing. And we present that to you. We commend ourselves in everything that applies to Christ and in building you up and bringing you into unity, making you a church of Christ, of God, that this is what he's not trying to say, I'm proud of this, but he is boasting that he is commending himself in everything about bringing the good news to them, to make them a solid church body, a solid body of Christ that is representing Christ to the people there at Corinth. And so he's saying, by great endurance, now here is where Paul gives his testimony to them, okay? He's saying, look, I've done it, and look at what I've had to go through because I've cared about you guys so much, and I've cared about you coming to Christ. I've cared about getting the good news to you. Look what I've had to endure, okay? Now, this is a serious thing because look at everything that Paul went through. Can any of us say we've gone through that? Look what he says. He's had to endure, right? By great endurance, okay, we see that Paul has gone through all kinds of problems everywhere he went to go present the news. Somebody was always right behind him, stirring the pot and causing problems, you know, and in many cases, he'd go to jail, he'd get beat up, he'd get stoned. Look at all the things he's gone through. So that's endurance because he went through all those and never gave up on continuing to present the good news to people, right? So he says, look, in everything, look at what I've had to endure for you guys. Great endurance by afflictions. We know Paul went through a lot, right? Even to the point, remember when he got on the boat to take him to Rome? Look what happened there, right? Ended up all the way out in Malta. They were in rough seas for 2 weeks to where nobody was even eating. And for all intents and purposes, it looked like they were going to die, right? That's just one. But think about the time he's been stoned. He's been beat up. He's been, you know, alienated. He's been, man, I mean, you look at everything that he's been through. He says by hardships. In other words, he's come to them too, going through considerable hardships to get to them. And hey, all of his ministry was that way. As a matter of fact, when you looked at the prophet Ananias, remember when, this is in Acts, remember when Paul was receiving his commission and God talked to the prophet Ananias and said, you need to go tell Paul, you know, that he's going to have to endure many things for my name's sake, and he will have to go through all these difficult times and everything. That was just some of the things that Ananias, the prophet Ananias, had to reveal to Paul. Well, we see that Paul really did have to go through all those things. I mean, God didn't make this a peachy little, you know, tour for Paul. I mean, Paul was going through all kinds of issues. He says, by hardships, by difficulties, by beatings. We know that, you know, Paul was whipped various times, by imprisonments. We can go read his story in Acts, and I'll tell you, all of these are brought out. By riots. Remember Thessalonians? You know, in Thessalonica and in Athens, and I mean, by riots, by labors, by sleepless nights, by times of hunger, by purity, by knowledge, by patience, by kindness, by the Holy Spirit, by sincere love. So we see that coming out of all of these difficulties, look where he comes to. He comes to those character values that are godly, right? That out of all those difficult times, he says, but look, this is all part of what it took to come to provide ministry to you all. And the good ones now change at verse 6, by purity, by knowledge, God's knowledge, right? By patience, by kindness, by the Holy Spirit, by sincere love, by the word of truth, by the power of God. And then we get a semicolon, through weapons of righteousness for the right hand and the left, through glory and dishonor, through slander and good report. So now he's bringing contrasts of things that he's had to deal with, regarded as deceivers, yet true. In other words, people were lying. Remember those that were coming up behind him? Remember in the church at Galatia? Remember how those that came in and gave them bad spiritual advice, and they, you know, were trying to get them into a works type of relationship, and Paul was kind of upset about that with them? Well, that's what he's talking about, you know, where when he was trying to provide witness and good news, others would come in and try to subvert it. And so he's saying, through glory and dishonor, there's that contrast, through slander and good report, and regarded as deceivers, yet true, as unknown, yet recognized, as dying, yet see, we live. Remember that one time he was taken out, you know, after being stoned, and they thought he was dead? There are some believe that he really was dead and that God brought him back to life. And I think in a way, the way it's worded, you could draw that conclusion. As being disciplined, yet not killed. Well, God hadn't finished with him yet, right? So he went through difficult times, but look, God kept him alive. As grieving, yet always rejoicing. As poor, yet enriching many. As having nothing. Hey, I love that one. As having nothing, yet possessing everything. I think that's awesome. You know, because, I mean, a lot of times we tend to think that, you know, especially in today's culture, we tend to look at, well, you know, if we're being blessed by God, shouldn't he be giving us a lot of stuff too? That's that kind of fleshly materialistic way of thinking, you know, because he's the one that is our everything, right? And in him, that's where we have everything we need. Yes, he will provide, but, you know, does it necessarily mean he's going to provide us $1 million house with 5-car garage? And you know what I'm talking about. That's not what he's talking about. You know, he's talking about that in Christ, we have everything we need. And that when we look to him and trust him, God's promises are that he will provide those things we need as we follow him. And we need to keep our focus on him. And so that's why he's saying, hey, in Christ, we've got it all. So, you know, why worry about all this other stuff? Like he said earlier, yet always rejoicing, you know, even though, you know, grieving may seem like, you know, the thing to do at that point in time, yet in it, we know God's in, you know, with us. And so he says, yet possessing everything. Verse 11, we have spoken openly to you, Corinthians. So now all of this stuff that he is sandwiching in here is showing that he has been a God's minister for them, even through these situations, good and evil, you know, and they are contrasted in the sense that says, look, I've had to endure all this because you guys were important to me and you were important to Christ, because that's why I gave you this ministry, this reconciliation, this bringing to you the good news so that you could come to Christ. And look at all the stuff I've had to endure. What have you guys had to endure? And in essence, by silence, he's kind of asking that question. You know, what have you had to endure? I've had to endure it because I love you. And I wanted to make sure that you guys have the truth. And so that's why he's saying, I've spoken openly to you, Corinthians. Our heart has been opened wide. Paul always said that he was praying for them, that it, no matter where he was, he always was, you know, concerned about those churches that he had planted or those that were in Christ. He'd always be praying for them. And so that's what he's talking about. Our heart has been opened wide. He says our heart, because remember, Paul had those that traveled with him at times. Okay, we know Titus and Silas and some others would travel with him. And so he's talking about that it's a collective joint venture that we do as the body of Christ to reach out to others. And in some cases, he may have sent Timothy to him, or he may have sent Apollos to him, or Silas, or Titus. But he does that. So in other words, all of that was done so that they could come to know Christ better. And so they weren't somebody that, you know, Paul just walked in one evening and said, okay, here's the truth, here's the gospel, and then walked out the next day, and it's like, okay, you know, sink or swim, see you later. No, he's been concerned all along to make sure that they're growing in Christ, and those that hadn't received Christ were receiving Christ and hearing the message of Christ, right? So he says in verse 12, we are not withholding our affection from you, but you are withholding yours from us. So in other words, what he's saying, look at everything that I've had to go through. Now, he's not saying I'm complaining about anything. He's just saying, hey, God is my strength, basically, right? It's God that provides. When we walk with the Lord, we look to him as our sustenance, as our strength, as our support in everything that we do. And so he's saying, look, I've never withheld our affection from you, but you are withholding yours from us. So in other words, there's this dysfunction, the disparity between some of those at the church in Corinth that weren't accepting Paul as, you know, God's real representative. They had their idea about who the right representative should be, and they had to fit the mold if they were going to be accepted. And Paul, in many ways, didn't fit that mold that those people in Corinth, or not everybody, but that group of people in Corinth were expecting. And we saw earlier in 2 Corinthians where Paul was talking about that you were to forgive that guy, basically, that was causing problems. Remember that one? That he had said, okay, hey, that was a guy that was probably very vocal about speaking against Paul and about who Paul was and everything. But Paul's saying, hey, forgive the guy, right? So we see that there is some dysfunction in that body. And there was antagonism towards Paul. But Paul's saying, look, I still hold you guys in affection, you know, and I'm still going to provide you the good news. I'm going to be a minister of Christ. I'm still going to provide the minister of reconciliation to you. I'm still going to uphold you to the Lord, to all, you know, come together as a strong body of Christ, growing in Christ daily. So he's saying, but you guys aren't reciprocating. You know, it should be that we are able to show love to one another regardless, okay? But there, he's saying, it's not happening, okay? You guys are with you know, you guys are withholding your affection to us. In other words, you have certain expectations and you're staying, you know, very solid, standing very solidly on those expectations, but those aren't the expectations that show that, you know, you care about us. You love us in the way Christ calls us to love one another. And so that's why he's saying that in verse 12. And he says, I speak as to my children, as a proper response, open your heart to us. So now some would say, well, is he talking about did he have biological children? Was he married after all? What? No, that's not what he's talking about. He's saying, I speak as to my children. In other words, I'm speaking to you in a way that you guys just haven't grown spiritually enough. So you're spiritual children. I speak to you as my children. So I have to really speak in ways that you can understand me, because you just haven't matured. You haven't gotten to a point where you're really reflecting the love of Christ the way you should. And so I'm having to basically provide you with these points, because, I mean, that's the only way you'll understand. And so he says, I speak to you as my children, as a proper response, open your heart to us. See, one of the things that I think the human nature does is it always wants what it wants. When we try to look at, you know, what we want, don't we go off the track? Because a lot of times what the flesh wants isn't necessarily what God wants. Okay. As a matter of fact, most of the time they will not mesh, because that's what the flesh is. The flesh is cursed. We've got a problem with the flesh. It is something that needs to be brought under control every day. Because if we don't bring the flesh under control, guess what? We're going to follow the desires of the flesh. But when we follow the desires of the Holy Spirit, when we walk by the way the Holy Spirit is giving us guidance to walk, then we don't carry out the desires of the flesh while we're walking by the Holy Spirit. Romans 8 says that. Galatians 5 talks about that. But if you want to do things on your own, and I'll tell you, that's a problem with the human nature, is most of us want to do something that say, look what I did. I accomplished this. Then you're pushing grace out the window, and all of a sudden it's about me. It's about what I'm doing. And that's not where we need to be. And those are the difficult things that Paul's trying to deal with the Corinthians here. That church at Corinth, is many of them have that issue. And they're just not growing the way they're supposed to. They're being too self-centered, egocentric, and not Christocentric. You know, in other words, they need to learn to walk by the Spirit so they won't carry out the deeds of the flesh. And that's where the problem is. And that's why they have this dysfunction in terms of what he's talking about in terms of affection, you know, because he's saying, look, you're my brothers and sisters in Christ. As a family member, I have affection for you, but yet you're not reciprocating that. See the problem that the flesh can bring when you're trying to walk by the flesh, or you're trying to make things fit the way you want them to fit, not necessarily the way God wants them to fit. It's easy to go down that path because, hey, we've got this flesh, and it's easy to get, you know, kind of wrapped up in what the flesh wants and not necessarily what Christ wants in our lives. And so that's what Paul is wrestling with up to this point, and that's what he's trying to address to the church there at Corinth. So any questions so far up through verse 13? Yeah, Paul really had to go through a lot. I mean, when you read all his letters and Acts, you know, the book of Acts that Luke wrote, I mean, you realize, man, it's amazing what Paul endured. Yeah, I think he endured the worst of all of them, you know, of all of those that we put in the category of the apostles, you know, when you look at it. I mean, there were others that were martyred before Paul, but, you know, I mean, the only one that wasn't martyred was John. All the others were, Paul included, okay, Peter included. So, I mean, we see that following Christ a lot of times isn't, you know, trouble-free, right? Or at least trouble-free from this body's perspective. But see, the beauty of following Christ, even if you have to give up the body, is where do you go? right? It's like, why would you want to stay here when you have eternal life and a wonderful place to be for the rest of our lives with our Lord and Savior forever and ever? Why would we want to stay here, right? Even Paul said that. He said, man, I'd rather be with Christ. I'd rather be with him, or die and be with him, than have to hang out here. But that God wants me to hang out here, so, well, yes, sir. You know, I'll stay, you know, and be the person you want me to be. And look at all, yeah.
He's using us all.
Yeah.
For purpose.
Absolutely. We are his vessels, right? Remember he talked earlier about, you know, the clay vessels, those, you know, that's what we are. We're a fragile vessel. But look, the whole power of God, a wonderful power of God is in us to represent him. Amen, Victor. Amen.
Sometimes I wonder, the Bible says God will meet all our needs, but like Paul went hungry, he needed food, and God didn't provide food, and Paul needed to be saved from being murdered, but God didn't meet that need. So sometimes I wonder, how can the Bible say God meets all our needs? Unless maybe where it says, I have nothing yet, I possess everything, maybe it doesn't mean he's going to meet our flesh, or, you know, we need food, that those kind of needs. I don't know.
No, he says, hey, I clothe, you know, the basically the grass of the field, the flowers, you know. In other words, and aren't you more important than they? Yes, I do. One of the things that you look at with Paul, he went hungry, but he didn't end up dying of, you know, starvation. He went through, one of the things that you find in following Christ, God will test us at times. He'll have us go through tough times, you know, to see where our focus is going to be. Is our focus going to be on the discomfort, or is it going to be on Christ, who is our provider and the one we trust? And with Paul, see, he says, in whatever state I'm in, I found that I can be joyful in whatever state I'm in. Because, in other words, he says, I can focus on Christ, and I know he's always there for me, that God is always there for me, no matter what. And when you get to that type of relationship with God, I think then you realize God is more important than if I go hungry for several days. You see what I'm saying? It's not going to kill you to not eat for some days. But, you know, yes, you may say, yeah, but, you know, can't God provide me some more food or something like that? Yes, he can. And as a matter of fact, you know, I mean, look at us here today. I mean, I don't think any of us have gone, you know, hungry for a long time, you know, if ever. But, I mean, in that time, hey, there were people that weren't in Christ that were going hungry. And we got people in the world today that are going hungry, right? And I mean, just talking about hunger. But there are many other things when you think about discomforts in this life. And I think one of the things that God does is he tests us to see how we're going to follow him. Are we going to keep our eyes on him regardless of situation? Go ahead, Victor.
Didn't God say, if I suffered, you're going to suffer too?
He did. Yeah, if they persecuted me, they'll persecute you, you know.
Right.
If they believe me, if they don't believe me, they're not going to believe you, right?
Right.
Yeah. So, go ahead, Mark.
I don't know if you can hear me. I'm in the cell phone.
Yeah, I can hear you.
It's true that God promised that he's going to supply our needs. But you also have to understand that what is God's will for that particular person at that particular moment? Well, you know, like Paul said, there were times that he was hungry. Well, only God knows why he allowed the Apostle Paul to go hungry at that moment. Not because God was not able to provide, because God provided if he wanted to. But there are times that God is going to allow us to go through difficult times in our life. And like you have mentioned, it will be for God's purpose to teach us a lesson. Or whatever situation that we don't know. But it is God's will that whatever situations that come to our life, that he's going to allow it to happen.
Yep. Amen. And that, yeah, it's about keeping our eyes on him no matter what. And he will, okay? He will provide in his time and at the time that is right to meet our need. I mean, to me, I think we need to be careful, too, to think that God always wants us to be 100% comfortable. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's not, you know, that's not really what we see in following Christ. I mean,
maybe it's how you define needs. Maybe it's how you define the word needs.
Well, true. Maybe
discipline.
Yeah. Well, I don't know. Look at, I mean, I grew up in Panama. Okay. And I'll tell you what, I grew up around a lot of poor shanty living people that, I mean, they had no running water in their homes. There were just kind of like these ditches outside, and that's where all of the refuse ran. I mean,
ew.
Yeah, but I'll tell you what, those people were content. I didn't hear them complaining about the fact that they didn't have food. Sometimes they had to go dig through trash to get food. So when I look at things like that, and yet I still see a level of joy through it all, I mean, all of a sudden you start realizing, man, I mean, we are really blessed. When you think about those people and, you know, looking at what they have to deal with, in a sense, I can kind of understand what Paul had gone through. And does it mean that God loved those people less, you know, because they live in those shanties? Or that God loved Paul any less because he let him go through those times? No. I think the issue is that we see that God is always there with us. And that we keep our eyes on him, and he is our sustainer. And like you said, sometimes we think our needs are more what we want, but really our needs are more what he wants for us. And so we need to keep our eyes focused on him to say, Lord, I know you're going to provide what it is that I need to be able to carry out your ministry and to join you in your work. And that's the real issue, is that is he providing what I need so that I can continue to do what he wants me to do day to day? And in that type of situation, I will say, yes, he will provide whatever your needs are as you're following the Father's will and carrying out the ministry he sent you to do. If you're living in a fleshly lifestyle, I can't make that kind of statement, you know, because it's when we follow him and our minds and our spirits are on track together that we are doing what it is that he's called us to do. Some would call that, you know, walking, you know, in the Father's will. I mean, and that's what it is. I mean, it's about reflecting God in a difficult world. And yet, yeah, go ahead, Mark.
Yeah, also, we also have to realize that sometimes as results of our action, you know, we have to pay a consequence because of our sin. As you know, sometimes there are people in an economic situation. It's because they have made some poor decision, and God will allow it to happen because they need to learn the lesson. I mean, if you did not show up to work, or you are always late, and you lost your job, and now you cannot provide, there are consequences.
Good point. Good point. I mean,
I heard a pastor say one time, "What we need is acceptance, belonging, and worthiness." So maybe that's our needs, not maybe food, clothes. I mean, we need food, clothing, and shelter. Sometimes God provides that, sometimes he doesn't.
Well, Jesus said, you know, Jesus had said, hey, that he will provide those things. He says, doesn't, you know, God knows that you have need for food and clothing. And he says, you know, doesn't he provide that? He does.
I feel like since our lives are all about bringing glory to him, I feel like sometimes if he doesn't provide what we consider a need, it's because he wants us to experience something that then we can feel for someone else who's going through that. And then when someone else brings up that need, we say, oh, you know what? This is what I did. I trusted the Lord. And because it's all about bringing glory to God, not about having our stomachs full or whatever.
Well, I like, you know, Donna said in the text that didn't he send birds to feed Elijah? Elijah was, you know, I mean, he was actually running from God at that point, wasn't he? But yeah, because he had just, you know, prayed and God brought down fire on that altar. And look at all those Baal prophets and Asherah prophets that were killed, 400 and some odd, right? But yeah.
Yeah, I went up against 400 prophets of Baal, and then he got scared of one woman, Jezebel, when she came along.
Yeah, Jezebel said, you'll be dead tomorrow. And he was running.
But to me, that's kind of an example of when we have a really big victory. Whenever you have a big victory, be careful, because you're going to have you're going to have a spiritual low after that spiritual high from that victory. And that's when the enemy is going to come along and try to.
Good point. Good point.
Dig up the seed that was planted or whatever, you know, just to, you know,
mess
take
with
away.
You.
to knock you off your little perch, you know, you're all happy that you had a victory. And then along comes the enemy and he, you know, comes up and boo.
Right. Right. But I think one of the things that is beautiful is that regardless of what situation you go through, I like what Paul said, no matter what state I'm in, whether in abundance or in want, that he could always be joyful in the Lord. That it wasn't about this physical body that was important. It was about his relationship with God that was more important than anything. And I think that that's where we need to be. We need to get to a point in our relationship with the Lord to where being apart from him would be more painful for us and more difficult for us than not having physical sustenance of some sort. You know, that as a matter of fact, you know, it talks about fasting in the Bible, and the fasting is a humbling before the Lord. So it's, you know, it's not a bad thing to go hungry for the Lord and to bring him honor and glory. It doesn't mean he's not providing. It just means that, you know, you're surrendering to him. You're humbling yourself before him. And I think those are important things. But I think sometimes we as Americans have been so spoon-fed that we feel like if I just miss a meal, then God's not blessing me anymore. And I think, you know, I think that we kind of get distracted by things like that in today's culture, you know, when, hey, the Lord's still there. And, you know, think about the points that Martin made. So, okay, let me move on over then to where he starts talking about separation from separation, you know, to and from God. Well, one of the things, have you ever heard, don't be unequally yoked? And usually it's always associated with marriage, right? Well, did you realize that that's not what Paul was talking about? He wasn't talking about marriage. But yet you can draw that conclusion from what he's talking about in terms of not being unequally yoked. Because, I mean, hey, what good is righteousness with unrighteousness? Okay, so, I mean, you can put that in the context of being married too. But it's not what he's talking about here. Here he's talking about what does, you know, godliness have to do with worldliness? You know, should we be yoked with worldliness? No, that's not it. I mean, in Christ, we should be new creatures. We should be separate from the world, right? We're not to be yoked with the world or the things of the world. We are to walk in Christ from then on. So let's look at what he says. Do not be yoked together with those who do not believe. Now, he's not saying don't go witness to unbelievers. He's saying don't be yoked with them. And Proverbs kind of brings that out, especially from chapters 10 on, where it talks about, you know, should the wise hang out with the foolish, you know? Or what about a person that goes in, what's the word that was used in Proverbs? A mocker, you know? Should you go, you know, make your bed with a mocker? In other words, should you go hang with a mocker? Or should you go hang out with an angry person and make a relationship with an angry person? And Proverbs is really clear. No, you don't go, you know, make relationships with those kind of people, because it's not that he's not talking about witnessing here now. He's talking about, you know, having relationships with people that are stuck in that type of a character. And so that's why he's saying, don't be yoked together with those who do not believe. In other words, he's saying those who aren't accepting Christ, period. They don't believe, okay? You've told them, maybe you've told them about the Lord, but they want to continue in their sinfulness. And so he's saying, hey, don't hang out there if they've rejected Christ. If they don't want to believe, don't hang with those people that have bad character values, okay?
So are you saying, like, it's saying don't fellowship with them?
That's right.
Okay.
I mean, fellowship is between believers, okay? He's saying don't make relationships with those kind of people. And as a matter of fact, John even talks about that in 1 John, where he says, hey, if someone even comes to your door, you know, that doesn't accept the thing of Christ. And I know Martin's brought this up before, like with Jehovah's Witness, you know, you shouldn't even invite them into your house. You know, it's not that you can't talk to them, but you got to be careful not to be drawn away by what they believe. And that's one of the reasons that he's talking about here. We shouldn't be partnered, as he puts in, for what partnership is there between righteousness and lawlessness? In other words, if you're walking in the way of the Lord, remember, we're still in the flesh. And if you start partnering with these people that have these problems in their lifestyle, you might get sucked into it too. Because remember, we're still flesh. Hey, and the spirit is willing, but what is it? The flesh is what's weak. See? So what he's saying, don't get wrapped up with those people that are rejecting God and you think that you're strong enough to overcome anything that they can throw at you. Because, hey, you may not be able to. And so he's saying, or what fellowship does light have with darkness? So in other words, should we go hang out in some kind of occult meeting? You know, where they're having an occult service, you know, worshiping Satan. Should we go hang out there? No.
No way.
No, we should stay away from that kind of behavior and that kind of pattern, because that does not reflect Christ. And it doesn't reflect he who is in us. Okay? Yeah, go ahead, Martin.
Yeah, hey, going back to the fellowship or having relationship, let's be more practical. If you are a Christian, should you go in a partnership with an unbeliever? You should not, because that will apply.
That's
right. I know that perfect example is, well, I would not hang out with a liar. So someone who practices lying, I would not hang out with a thief. Imagine, like, it has happened. You go to Home Depot, you're hanging out with someone, and he goes and grabs something, put it in his pocket. And then you're walking out of Home Depot, and you're going to be stopped. Well, why an embarrassment? You know what I mean? So you should not hang out with people like that.
That's right. And it'd be a bad testimony too, right? Because now you're in Christ, but what are they believing? They're believing you're a thief because you're with that thief.
Exactly.
Exactly. So, yeah, no, Julie, what I'm talking about is these are people that maybe the gospel has already been presented to them. It's not about the opportunity to talk to them about Jesus. It's about the fact that these are people that have rejected, you know, Christ. They want to continue in their lifestyle. So what Paul is talking about, don't hang with people that display that, because they might suck you in. And like Martin was saying, you might get associated with their lifestyle just by virtue of the fact that you're with them. And it's not that you can't talk to them about Christ. It's that they've rejected Christ. Go ahead, Julie.
I have a question, because when I used to work as a nurse for the health department, I used to work with transgender, lesbians, and people that they don't believe in God. And I used to, in my own time, my lunch time, I used to do Bible study for whoever wanted to hang out, and they actually would be, they just want to be in the group. And I say, okay. And they will pray with you and everything. I didn't reject it. So do that wrong?
No, not at all. No. That's not what Paul's talking about here. Paul's talking about going and hanging with those people while they're doing their sin, and you're actually in it with, not necessarily sinning, but you're there with them. And so you're being associated with them, or, you know. But in this case, you're talking about actually, you know, sitting down in a Bible study. That's what we're called to do. And we're called to give, you know, to provide to sinners. It's not for us to judge them. It's for us to tell them the good news. And in the case of what you were doing, that's what we're called to do. Paul is not talking about that. He's saying here that those who do not believe, in other words, these are those people that have not believed at all, even though the good news has been provided for them, you don't go, you know, hang with them in their lifestyle while they're doing their stuff, because it reflects back on you. The world will just think you're part of them and their lifestyle, the way they're living it, when you're doing what Paul's talking about here. It's not about an opportunity to witness. It's not an opportunity for them to come to Christ. It's talking about people that have already said they don't want anything to do with Christ, and yet you're hanging with them anyway in their situation. You see what I'm saying?
Yes. But I have a question. They did not believe in God, but they still want to hear the word of God, and they were still doing the same thing. And they will ask me, but do you think I will still get saved? I'm like, and I will answer them. I say, that's between you and God. I cannot judge you, because that's between you and God. But you could continue Bible study and listen, because I cannot tell them not what to do, especially when they're transgender, because I'm trying to bring them to Christ, and I didn't want to push them away neither.
No, that's understandable. And I mean, Donna says we need to avoid all appearances of evil. But in the case of what you were doing, hey, you were reaching out to them. Remember, you can't make them change. Only God can make them change.
I wasn't talking about Julia appearing evil. I was talking about you when you said go hang out and do the things with the people. And you said that, I was backing up what you were saying about they don't know whether you're just like them or you're doing the same thing. So if you hang out with people that are doing evil things or participating with them in their evil, then people, you're appearing evil, you know, doing, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, no, I know what you were saying. I wasn't trying to associate that with what Julie was doing. I'm sorry if that came across that way. That's not what I was trying to.
Clarify, because I wasn't telling Julie that's what I was saying. That's
right,
what I
right.
was trying to.
No, that's true. No, what you were doing, Julie, was right. Hey, we've got to reach out to sinners. Who else is there? We're all sinners. But the reality is, you know, we tend to categorize sin, don't we, Julie? A lot of times we may tend to say, oh, but that's a transgender person. Oh, there's no way God can say, yes, he can. God can do, I mean, where God's grace is involved, hey, he can save anybody. If he could save Ted, he can save anybody, okay? And the issue is, yes, in that type of situation where we are going out and sharing the gospel, that's what we're called to do. And we are called to do it in amongst sinners. We can't change their lifestyle. We can point them to the truth, but only God can change them. Only the Holy Spirit can do that changing in their lives once they've come into a relationship with Jesus Christ. It's not going to change before Christ has come in, I guarantee you. Because if you start thinking that a person has to change that those types of decisions that they've made in their life, then none of us could be saved. Because none of us can get out of sin except through by God's grace. None of us can, period. And we don't actually stop sinning. It's only by his grace that we are forgiven for our sin. So it's not that we go sinning on more. We just, as we get closer to Christ, the sin should become less problematic to us. You know, as that song says, right? Doesn't it? For the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. The closer we get to him, the closer we get in relationship to Jesus Christ, the less sin has a hold on us. And that's why the Bible's clear about walking by the Spirit. The more we become tighter with the Spirit, hear the Spirit's call, then the less we will have a desire to want to go in sin. And it will transform us, as Romans 12:2 is talking about. So that's what he's talking about. Let's see here.
Okay.
Yeah, go ahead there. Yeah,
it's like a fisherman. Yeah, a fisherman goes fishing. He wants to catch a fish, right? So it's a perfect example. Obviously, you want the sinner to come in and listen to the word of God.
Amen. Amen. Let's see. Jenna is saying something. Let's see here. Because you were studying God's word, he will cover you, and your light was shining enough to bring those individuals to want to know more about his word. I think she's talking to you, Julie. Keep studying and praying in their presence and allow the Holy Spirit to reveal God's will in their lives. Continue to be a beacon of life in their path of darkness. Yeah, you're right, Janet. It's not us that changes the person, but it is us, as Paul just talked about here to the Corinthians, to bring that message of reconciliation, to bring that truth that God has provided, not in a judgmental way, but in a loving way. And let God, through his Holy Spirit, do the work in their lives as they turn their lives over to him. Yes, absolutely. They wanted to come to your Bible study, so God was drawing them to your group. Yes, that's what Sally says. So, and exactly, Donna says, and the word becomes that surgical instrument. It becomes that truth. And as God builds that truth into the life of sinners, we get transformed. We get changed. We know our desires are changed from the world to being the desires of what God wants in our lives, right? So that's where we get focused. And that's what Paul is talking about here. He's not talking about going out and witnessing to people. He's talking about making relationships with those people who have rejected Christ and God. And you don't go make relationships with people that don't want to hear about God in their lives, don't want to change. They don't want to. I'm not saying be hurtful to them or be unloving towards them. I'm just saying don't make a partnership with them. Because if you do, you might end up in the same situation as Martin's example showed, okay? And that's why Paul says, for what partnership is there between righteousness and lawlessness? In other words, if you're going to go out and follow somebody that's doing law-breaking stuff, there are consequences. And you're going to get sucked into it in the process. We're not talking about sharing the good news here. We're just talking about joining them in their sinful endeavors. Don't. Stay away from it. Look what else he says. Or what fellowship does light have with darkness? In other words, we don't go hang with darkness. We don't go to an occult meeting thinking, hey, I might be able to witness to those people there. No, it's the wrong setting. That's not, you know, where you go to bring the good news to those people. You know, a person, you know, even though a person may be an occultist worshiping Satan, hey, it doesn't mean they can't be saved. It may, but it may not. But that's not the setting you go to go end up trying to tell them, hey, Jesus loves you, while they've got, you know, this goat that they're worshiping there, and they're doing inordinate things, right, of the flesh, because that's what Satan does. So we've got to be careful with that type of situation. To me, because Paul is mentioning it here to the Corinthians, I think there is some problem going on in that respect. I think what they're doing, remember earlier, it talked about that they were going into the temples, those, you know, temples, and they were using temple prostitutes, and he talked against sexual immorality. And, you know, the problem is, that's what he's talking about here. Look where they were going. They were going to those temples of Ashtoreth so that they could, you know, worship, so to speak, by using the temple prostitutes. See, that's what Paul's talking about. We don't have, that's not where you go to reflect Jesus Christ. As a matter of fact, when you go there, what does the world see? They see you as being part of that group, don't they? If you go to a bar every day and in your heart you say, well, I'm going to go witness there, the people that see you going in there say, you're going to a bar. You're not a Christian.
Mm-hmm.
You see the issues that you run into? You got to be careful what image you portray. If we're Christ, then we need to portray Christ properly. Not by those things that, you know, fall into the things of the world. In the right type of environment, yes, we witness, we love, we tell people how to get out of their sin, that through Jesus Christ, he's the answer. And by grace, they can be saved through faith. But we don't end up going into these areas that do not characterize what a follower of Christ Jesus would be seen too frequent. You see, that kind of thing. So we've got to be careful. And that's what Paul is talking about here. You know, you don't go hang out in these places to feed the flesh and then say, oh, that's okay. Not a problem. Don't worry about it. See the issue that you run into? If you do partner with evil and lawlessness or darkness. So look, he even goes further. In verse 15, he says, what agreement does Christ have with Belial? In other words, should we, as Christ followers, be hanging out in places that worship Satan? No. Should we be going to these temples where God, I mean, the Bible is clear that idols were demons? No. Why would we want to go in there? That's not where we're to be. We're to be apart from that kind of thing. God is clear that we as Christ followers should have nothing to do with Satan. But yet, you know, some people think, oh, I can go there. I'm fine. I'm already protected by God. So, you know, hey, if I can eat food offered to idols, what's bad about having sex with one of those prostitutes in the temple? You know, I'm already protected. Well, no, you know. And that was what Paul was talking to the Romans about in Romans 6:1. You know, they thought that they could just go sin all the more and then just get more grace from God to kind of cover that. Well, that's the wrong logic. It's not spiritual logic. It's flesh logic. And so that's what God calls us to be separate from. And so then he continues on, or what does a believer have in common with an unbeliever? In other words, just to go hang for hanging's sake without any desire to want to tell them about the gospel or to be there, that's not the right people to hang with in those type of situations. Yes, we may have a hunger to want to tell them about Christ, but that's not what Paul's talking about here. There were those in Corinth who were doing these things, you know, because they wanted to be accepted by those people, not because they wanted to go witness to them. They just wanted to say, yeah, but you know how when you come to Christ, sometimes you have to change your friends, you know, because there are some that, man, they just, you know, they want to stay in their sin. They're fine with it. And it's not that, you know, we're all sinners. Yes, we are. But some of the people just don't want to change. And if you hang with them, like Sally says, what do you come up with? Peer pressure. And then before you know it, you're a new Christian. You're going to be back sinning the same way you were before because you're hanging with them. See the issue that we're talking about here? That's what Paul is talking about. And he says, and what agreement does the temple of God have with idols? So see, again, they're frequenting these temples. They're sinning. And that's not what God has called them to. It's not talking about witnessing here. He's talking about those things that we do in the flesh because that's what we want to do. Oh, good night, Andy. God bless you guys. Take care, you and Tina.
Doesn't action speak louder than words?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah, Martin.
Yeah, like you mentioned, okay, it is true that we are sinners, but there's a difference between the Christian and those that practice sin.
Amen.
Okay. In general, yes, we are sinners, but we're not practicing sin.
That's right.
And we don't dwell in sin. So there is a difference between the Christian and the unbeliever.
Good point.
And I think like you were saying, Martin, about the thief, if you go into Home Depot, but I was also thinking a gay bar. Does the Lord want us going into a gay bar because, oh, we're going to minister to the gays? No, because then, you know, that's sending the wrong message. People see you going into a gay bar and, oh, see, mm-hmm. You say it's okay. It doesn't matter what the Bible says. And it's like, no, it's all about the appearance of what's going on.
Actions.
And I will add that you are going basically into a sinner territory. As you know, there were cases, I think, you know, what happened with the Pulse. Some people were there, supposedly they were not gay, but they end up being there. I'm saying to myself, if I get invited for a situation like that, will I go? No, I will not.
Right. Yeah. I do like Julie's comments, though, because, I mean, in her situation, she had the right setting. Wasn't trying to say, hey, I want to be one with you and this, you know, LBGYN. It's, I want to tell you about a better way. And the situation was one where you could do it without people judging you as to, oh, if you're a Christian, why are you doing this? So no, you're right, Julie.
Well, like Elke was saying, that we're just throwing out seeds. So in Julie's situation, she was throwing out the seeds, like
exactly
the word asked her to.
Amen. Amen.
But I have something to say. Like Martin say something about the polls, about people that there was not gay or no, and I believe that the thing is sometimes, like for the health department, for us as a co-work, as a workers, even that I was a Christian, I had to go to the gay walk on Disney, just part of my job. So we don't know if that people that was not gay, they was there, they must part of their job, that they didn't have no choice. Like,
right, that's right.
I had no choice to go to the gay walk, to the HIV walks, to the all of this no believer, and they would be like looking at me, and they was like, "Oh, she's always quiet, but she's an example." So it's sometimes you don't have no choice, but it's like the Bible says, you just have to be wise the way that you act in the front of the outside, in the front of the non-believer.
Yeah, but see, God knows the heart, Julie, and see, God knows if you're there to represent him, or if you're there to represent the world. And in this case, because you had Bible studies and whatnot for these people, see, you are already representing Christ. You are already making an example. Hey, guess what? Our work environment is a place that we're put to witness. You know, if we say, well, sorry, I can't work in a job because, well, there's gay people in there. Well, then, we're cutting off that opportunity to be able to bring the truth to those people. So, I mean, in the situation, the way you're talking about it, Julie, you were representing Christ. You were being light in darkness. You weren't being darkness along with darkness. See, and that's what Paul's talking about here. There were some people that weren't really following Christ. Even though they say they were Christians, they were out with unbelievers. They were out in these temples with idols. They were out living an improper life, yet they were supposedly Christians. See, that's...
It's not easy, because it was so funny. It was between get a transfer. When I got a transfer, I didn't know what I was going to get into. And when I got there, I say, Lord, why in the world you put me? And I learned my lesson. It was your decision. I even bring one of the girls to Christ before she actually passed away, that she ended up with cancer.
Yeah.
But it was really hard. I even got one of the manager was not Christian, and she will say, "Oh, you cannot have Bible study in your lunch." And I'm saying, "But it's my lunchtime. It's my time." "Oh, but you're using the building." We will go across the street, sit down in the tree with a blanket, all of us, and they will still say, she will bring me to the office, say, "Ma'am, I'm going to put you in counseling." And I'm like, why in the world she's going to put me in counseling? I'm going to actually preach the counselor too.
Amen.
That's what I told her.
You go. That's the right way. Yeah.
Amen. No, you're right. I mean, God puts us in places that a lot of times may be uncomfortable. But see, if we go in there representing Christ, that's different than going in there and trying to be one of the crowd. You see, and what Paul's talking about here are those that were trying to be one of the crowd and doing, and if they sinned, it was no big deal. See, that's wrong. Go ahead, Martin.
Yeah, I just got to say, we got to make a distinction between, let's say, your job and pleasure. You're like, look, at one time, I have tenants. I have rented to lesbian. I think, amen. No, we're not going to discriminate because they are homosexual.
Right.
God forbid. Amen. But there's a distinction between you doing your job and then you're doing other things for pleasure.
That's
now,
right.
If you go invited to a bar, that's a situation. You don't have to go. But if you have work, of course you're going to serve everyone we love, because that is our job.
Amen. Amen. So, I mean, and that's the issue here. The issue here isn't about them witnessing at this point, you know, like he was talking about in the message of reconciliation. These are these people that were purposefully living a life that was in areas where it wasn't bringing honor and glory to God, and they were doing it even in their sinful nature. See, they weren't
like
trying
to stay away. Like in debauchery?
Oh, they were going, like I said, they were going to the temples and having sex with the prostitutes at the temples. They were, you know, doing, that's idolatry by going to the temple anyway. See, and so they're, and that's why he says, and what agreement does the temple of God have with idols? See, he's saying, you're the temple of God. What are you doing over there in those temples where there are idols and you're imbibing in the sexual activity with those temple prostitutes? In other words, you can't have God and the world. You know, you can't say, yeah, I can do God today and I'll do the world tomorrow. It's no, either we are his or not, you know. And so what does Donna say? What about going into the bar with a team to evangelize? My point is that is not the environment, because all you're doing is you're antagonizing a group of people. Now, I'm not saying that God can't do a miracle. I'm just saying that, you know, those type, when you're doing it in that type of setting, Donna, you're opening up the door to, I mean, there are a lot more places to go out and meet the people, you know, because think about it. What good is it to evangelize to somebody that's schnockered, you know, seven sheets to the wind? Do you think their heart is going to be right before the Lord right then and there, that they're going to hear the Holy Spirit, you know, when they're, you know, yeah, anyway. So, I mean, I can understand where Paul's going with this, because some Christians will say, yeah, but I'm fine. I'm protected by God. I don't got to worry, you know, and that's not what Paul is saying here. Okay. So look at what he says then. He goes on and he says, and what agreement does a temple of a God have with idols? For we are the temple of the living God. So we, as the temple of God, shouldn't we be doing things that bring honor and glory to God? We shouldn't be living in our sin, as Martin put it, practicing sin. That's not what we're called to, you know, and there's no excuse to it. But look at what he brings out, you know, that was said in, you know, Leviticus. I will dwell and walk among them. I will be their God and they will be my people, right? So when if God's going to be in us and walking amongst us, remember in the Old Testament it talked about ceremonial cleansing. There was a lot you had to do to get clean before the Lord. Well, Jesus does that for us. And through his grace, he cleanses us. But now, because we're cleansed, does that give us freedom and license to go out and sin more? No, of course not. And because God's our God, we need to be holy as he is holy, right? So look what God told them. Therefore, come out from among them and be separate, says the Lord. Do not touch any unclean thing, and I will welcome you. So in other words, God is saying, look, I'm holy. Don't be taking me where I'm not supposed to go. That's not, you know, that's not the environment where I've called you to be. You know, I will give you direction and there will be times to be able to witness to people, but don't go into, you know, don't go into a satanic temple for heaven's sakes. You know, that's not where I call you to be, because I'm in you. You're God's temple. We need to reflect God in the right environment. Yeah, there will be places we go to witness for the Lord, but not those places, because it makes it seem like that's what we're part of, and we are not part of that. God is not part of that darkness. So he says in verse 18, and I will be a father to you, and you will be sons and daughters to me, says the Lord God Almighty. And that's what Romans 8 talks about. When we accept Jesus Christ as our Savior, we're adopted into a family. We're adopted into his family. As he said earlier, and you know, we are his ambassadors, right? In chapter 5. If we're his ambassadors, chapter 5, verse 20, for Christ, and he makes his appeal through us, shouldn't we be reflecting him in everything we do and in representing him properly in the way he's called us to be? Absolutely. So we need to keep our eyes on him all the time and look to him to walk in his righteousness and reflect him in everything we do. Not to try to, you know, somehow find a loophole and a license to go do things that are sinful and practice sinfulness, because what does light have to do with darkness? That's what Paul's message is right there as he's wrapping up because we have the message of reconciliation. Let's take that to the world in a way that brings honor and glory to God, not in any way that diminishes the power of God. And I love what Julie did. That's what it is. That's taking light to darkness, okay, and the way that we're called to do. Amen. Any questions, comments about our Bible in chapter 6, because that's what we covered tonight. I think that it's an important thing, but think about it. If Paul was dealing with this, with them, the Corinthians, think about it. Are we dealing with it today? Is there a problem out there today maybe that we're dealing with? I think so. And we need to be open to following Christ the way he's called us to follow him, right? Amen. So that's the study this evening. Any final questions, comments, contributions, agreements, disagreements? Yeah, go ahead, Mark.
I would just add that, you know, we are privileged that God has entrusted us with the ministry of reconciliation. Amen. In other words, we are the ambassador. Tell people, look, you don't have to be against God. God has reconciled you through Christ Jesus. There is reconciliation because people, as you know, this madness that the world is running today. And sometimes I drive out there and says, man, that guy is driving like the devil's chasing him. Because people are mad and you look at them. Well, you know, once you are reconciled with Christ, you don't have to run your life that way anymore. Amen. You have peace in your heart.
Amen. And I'll tell you, it's that peace that surpasses understanding that Philippians 4:7 talks about. You know, I mean, that Amen. Is the peace we want as we walk with Christ. And I guarantee you that if you go into the wrong places and it's not really the Holy Spirit that's driving you there, you will not have that peace in there. I guarantee you. It won't be there.
Nope. And as you know, people are trying to solve the world's problem with their force, with their own strength. And unfortunately, as you know, it's not going to happen that way. Nope. You could destroy, you could kill, you could evil, but it's not going to happen. Because the only one that's going to change people's heart is the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Hallelujah. That's right. I mean, that's the beautiful picture. That's the beautiful picture. And that's what you were doing, by the way, Julie. You know, you were letting the Holy Spirit work through you to them. Okay?
It wasn't easy.
No, of course not. No, the Lord didn't ever say everything was going to be easy in following him. And in the people we have to interact with. Yep.
You know, they used to do in the Christmas party get together that we all have to be present as employee. There will be, she had to pray in the front of everybody before we eat. And I'm like, why? In my mind, why? But they always will make me go in the front of everybody with a microphone just to pray. And I'm like, Lord, give me the word because I don't know what.
Yeah, because you didn't want to alienate anybody, but you still wanted to show the love of Christ through. And actually, that's not a bad thing. You know, the Holy Spirit works in mysterious ways. God works in mysterious ways.
Well, and they were calling you to pray. So obviously they saw something different in you.
Amen.
You were bringing the light.
That's happened to me a lot, too. When I go, like, in the community where I live, I've gone to some of the, you know, functions that they have. And some of them are Christians, but a lot of them aren't. But even the person that asked me to pray, they're not a Christian. But they always ask me to pray over the meal. So I consider it an honor.
Amen.
Yes, amen.
Amen to that. And there are times we make other people uncomfortable. We have to remember, look, it's not us. They just, like the Bible said, darkness hate the light. So we represent the light. Basically, they don't hate us. They hate the one who lives in us, which is the Holy Spirit.
Christ. Amen. Amen to that. I'll tell you, you're right, though. I can empathize with you, Julie, and I just praise God for you, my sister. That's awesome. That's awesome.
Well, because Ted was in the Navy. We all know everything about what's said about sailors, right? And yet, obviously, the Lord had put him there in the midst of all that debauchery, you know, to bring light, bring glory to God in the middle of all that.
And he does. And he does. You know.
And you know what it was, a funny thing? And now I'm just laughed, but it came into my mind after that, after many years, instead of giving me layoff, they all transferred me to another unit. And the manager, she was lesbian. She started falling in love with me. And that I said, thank God that I got, at that point, I say, Ivan, thank God that I got sick. I didn't want to be sick, but I'm like, I didn't have no choice even to leave the job. But I'm like, God, take me out. Not the way I really want, but I, you know.
Yeah. Well, I'll tell you, in the Navy, I had one guy come up to me and tell me what a nice looking bum I had. I was like, excuse me? I don't think so. I don't want to hear that talk. So, but it goes to show that we're in a fallen world. And I mean, hey, guess what? That's what people do. We're sinners. And those are the people we reach out to. We still reach out to them because who knows who God's mercy will fall on, and he will shower grace on them and bring them into the fold and change their hearts and their minds, you know? That's what we're called to, is to represent him. Not to say, oh, I don't want nothing to do with you, you know? Because it's easy to get prejudiced, right? And say, well, not that person. I mean, God wouldn't want that person. Well, if that's the case, well, then he wouldn't want any of us because we're all sinners. So it is.
Well, I remember one time when a lesbian girl fell in love with me, and I was like, opened my eyes wide, and I'm like, I'm heterosexual. Well, that got her gone.
Yeah, but that's the world, you know? Yeah. That's the world.
And I think it was just because I was being nice to her. You know, the rest of the group was ousting her, and I was being nice to her, and I think she misinterpreted that niceness as that I was in love with her. And it's like,
not that kind of love, right?
Not that kind of love, no.
Amen.
When I used to have the opportunity to talk to them, I asked them, I went straight, say, I don't want you to get offended, but I say, why you choose that life, you know? And some of them being abused, some of them being not, they never got the you know, the Bible on the front to study. They didn't have the structure for nobody.
Right.
I have one person that never knew about God until I introduced her to her. That's the one that she had cancer and passed away, but she actually believed God.
Right. So, I mean, that's important, isn't it?
Yeah.
I mean, we've got to be open to what God leads us, who God leads us to, and to show love to those people. But it doesn't mean, you know, putting God aside and getting involved with them at their level. That's the difference in terms of what Paul is talking about here tonight to the Corinthians. Because I think he had quite a few people in there that were doing just that. And he's saying, you can't have light with darkness. Come on, guys. You know, you can't take your temple into an idolatrous temple. It's not right. There's a dysfunction there. That's not the environment where people are ready to listen to the Holy Spirit. You see what I'm saying? So we need to be open to his calling and show love where we need to show love. Amen. Anybody else?
Good Bible study. Good feedback and interaction.
Amen. Yes. Okay. Tonight's
meeting.
Oh,
thanks, Ted, for leading. Thank you.
Hey, my pleasure.
Amen.
Hey, tonight we have Victor. See, he's back in the hospital. See him in his bed over there. But you said you're being released tonight or tomorrow?
Tomorrow.
Okay, tomorrow. So we keep him in prayer. David Washburn, for those who have been at our Wednesday Bible studies back at First Baptist, you would have known David. He's in the hospital. Possibly a heart attack, and tomorrow they're doing a catheter to his heart, okay, to do some checking to see what's going on there. So we want to keep him in prayer. And then Pastor David on Sunday did mention the brain tumor that Donna brought up in our last meeting on Saturday. And so that's something we need to pray about, that God will, you know, resolve that matter in the way that he has set up. So Any other prayer items that you want me to pray for?
I have a prayer.
Sure, go ahead, Julie.
My son, even the ex-wife is not following the court direction that because the coronavirus, she's supposed to be FaceTime him or call him every day. And he called every day and she will not let him to talk or see his daughter. So that's being a lot in my son's play. It's not being easy because my son is a really, really good father. So, and he's always been there for her. So it's been hard for him because he want to be there for her, but the court say for both parents, the child should not be, for the sake of both parents should be not being back and forth. But the mother, she's so bad and she's not a Christian either. They do a lot of voodoo and stuff. She lately in the last 3-4 days, she not been letting my son being talking to his daughter over the phone, and it's hard for my son, you know, it's been overwhelmed for him. Plus today when Ivan and me went to the doctor because the car accident that we had, they say that we had hernia disc, so they're going to start
herniated disc. So are they going to do back surgery?
Until now, thank God, we don't need surgery, but they're going to do a lot of treatments and they send us to a chiropractor. We'd be in pain, but you know, we just take it day by day.
Amen. Amen. But we'll be praying that God will fix your back on that. Yeah. Amen. Okay. Janet is saying to pray for a friend's daughter. She attempted suicide Sunday night, and kids are feeling overwhelmed with school situation and having loneliness. Pray for our kids. Amen.
Yeah.
I'll tell you, this is a different normal. And I hate to say it, but it's not a good normal in many cases. Amen. Yeah, go ahead, Mark.
You please add there my neighbor, Chuck. He's still going with chemo when he's cancer in his blood, I think it is. Yeah, he was just in the hospital. He came out yesterday.
Okay.
He lost like 50 pounds. Chuck, my neighbor.
Chuck. Okay. Man, 50 pounds.
Man. He's skinny.
That chemo is nasty stuff. I hate to say it. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, we'll pray for Chuck.
I'd like to give a shout out to everybody who's been praying for me, family, friends, church, the whole set of you good people out there, and prayer from all my caretakers here at the hospital and my neighbors at home who are helping out with Margaret right now.
Okay. You got it, brother. Anybody else? Okay, let's pray then. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you once again for a great time as brothers and sisters to come together and study your word, and that your Holy Spirit gives us insight and understanding as we all contribute. And we see those things that were not only problematic in the Corinthian church, but are problematic in our world today. But yet we're called to follow you, to be light in darkness. And to reach out, like Julie was doing in her job, that we thank you for that kind of, you know, persistence amongst our believers today who understand what it is to reach out and share the love of Christ with others so that your Holy Spirit will do the work in their hearts according to your will, Heavenly Father. And we thank you, Lord, that you just are with us through it all. And in all things, you shower grace on us way beyond anything we deserve. Let us get closer to you, Lord Jesus, to the point where the things of this world do become just strangely dim in the light of your glory and grace. Now, Lord, I want to pray for Victor. I thank you that, you know, I mean, it looks like they've been able to resolve the matter that he was dealing with this time that he's gone into the hospital. But, Lord, please heal him totally, Lord, and so that he doesn't go back again, and just resolve this whole issue with that bleeding that he's been having. But Lord, we also want to thank you, you know, through Victor, for the caretakers that he's had there at the hospital. Bless them, and also bless his neighbors who have been taking care of, looking out for Margaret back at the house. We thank you for that. We pray also for David Washburn, who's in the hospital. Give wisdom and insight and skill to the doctors as they're caring for him. But above all, give them the right ability and skill when they do this catheter tomorrow. And hopefully they can see what needs to be done and bringing David back into health again, Lord. Give them direction and guidance and give peace to David as he's there. Also, Lord, I pray for Pastor David and the matter of the brain tumor. I don't know anything more specific than that, but Lord, you know. And so we put the pastor in your hands. Lord, thank you for everything you've done to bring him back to the body. And also because he was able to preach last Sunday, thank you. We've been praying for him and you've been faithful and you have put your healing hand on him. So now, Lord, we pray that you resolve this matter in the right way according to your will and purpose, this brain tumor thing that he's got. Also, we've been bringing up Julie's son to you throughout the weeks. Lord, we want to really raise this matter up again because, his son is being kept, even though there is a judicial mandate, a court mandate, that he is supposed to be able to see or, well, at least talk to his daughter. And his ex-wife is not following that. Now, I know that she most likely is not a believer in you, but Lord, there is nothing to say that you still can't get her attention, Lord. We pray that you would be involved in this and that, Julie's son would be able to get, opportunity to be able to talk to his daughter. Lord, because not only is that right judicially and by the court, but it is the right thing in terms of, him being the father of that child and being able to talk to her and interact with her. So Lord, please fix that situation, I pray, and open it up. Also pray for Ivan and Julie both as, they've been checked out from the car accident and the herniated disc issues that they're dealing with. Lord, that you would put your healing hand on them and that whether it be through physical therapy or through the chiropractor, that they would be able to resolve this thing. And because, that's painful, Lord, to have herniated disc. So we ask for your involvement in this and that they would be relieved from that, Lord, I pray. I also pray for Martin's neighbor, Chuck, who's been dealing with this chemo thing. Man, that can really be problematic. But Lord, we pray for him before, and I pray that you would put your hand on him and just let him know that you are there for him in the midst of this whole cancer thing that he's dealing with. Because we look to you, Lord, you are Jehovah Rapha, God the healer. And we want to be able to give you all the glory, the honor, and the praise for any and every healing that's going on out there. And we know that you care and that you do love Chuck, Lord. So we put him in your hands. I also want to pray for Janet Lusk's friend's daughter, the one who attempted to commit suicide Sunday night, Lord, that you would reach out to that family and give peace to the family. But more than anything, Lord, to their daughter. You know why she attempted to commit suicide. You know what's going on there. But Lord, there's a solution in it all, but it has to come from you. In and of ourselves, we can do nothing, Lord. So our eyes are on you. And we trust you, Lord, to bring peace to that family and also to bring insight to that daughter and show her why what she is doing is not, right. And Lord, that you would just give direction and guidance there and get her attention in whatever way would bring her into a relationship with you, Lord Jesus. And also pray for the schools and the kids, with this new normal that's out there and some kids having to stay home and not being able to be with their friends, or if they are going to school, there is separation and no ability really for interaction. And that's not very good for the psychological development of the children, regardless of which situation they fall under to get education. We pray for your peace in the matter here, but more than anything, Lord, we pray for some solution to this coronavirus thing so that it can finally be brought under control so that people can get back to living the life of normality, I guess we could say. But more than anything, Lord, is that you would get the honor and the glory for the resolution and that we could all come to a a new and better understanding of you and a closer relationship with you in everything we do. Lord, I also pray for our president and for our nation. Lord, that you would just reach out to us, because I know we've drifted so far from you as a nation, Lord, and I pray that we would get our bearings back and get focused right and walk with you, because, I mean, man, you know, there's nothing good about being separated from you, Lord Jesus, but following you and trusting in you, as our currency indicates, would really bring us into a proper relationship, and you would be there to be our God, and we would be your people. So we ask that hearts be changed and updated in our culture and in our country and society, Lord. I also ask, Lord, that you just be with each and every one of us. I know there are many prayer requests that weren't even mentioned, but you know each and every need. You know each and every heart. You know our families. You know those interactions and where there's dysfunction. So we put those all before you, Lord, and we trust you. We look to you, Lord, because we need you. That's the reality. We can't do anything in and of ourselves, but we can rely on you for it all. Now, Lord, be with us as we go, I pray, and that you would be with us in everything that we do to bring you honor and glory, and that you be glorified in everything. We thank you for your loving kindness. Thank you for this Bible study tonight, and open our hearts in a way that we can put it into practice in a way that reflects you, and that we would share your good news at every opportunity that with the Holy Spirit's direction and guidance. We love you and we praise you, and we give you the honor and the glory in Jesus' precious name. Amen. All right, you, everybody. You guys right, have a great night. Evening.
Good night.
Good night. Yeah, good night, Margaret. Hey, good night, Mary. Great having you here tonight.
Thank you.
Yeah.
You could join us. Awesome.
Good night, Donna. What's that, Donna?
I was telling Mary I'm glad that she could make it.
Amen. Amen.
Good night. Thank
good
you.
Night. Good night. Bye. Hey, Victor, great having you. It's great to see that even in a hospital, you can join us, brother.
On the cell phone, it's giving me problems.
Yeah, but it's working fine now, so praise the Lord.
Join us.
Amen. The nurse helped.
Make this looking good.
Amen. Amen.
Yeah.
Hey, good night, Aaron. God bless you, my brother.
Good night. Good night, good night, everybody.
Hey, give love to the family, brother.
We'll do.
All right. Good night, everybody.
Good night.
Good night, Martin. Thank give you. Love to Wendy.
Thank you.
Bye.
You got it. God bless. Hey, Julie, great input tonight. Thank you for everything for you and Ivan. Hey, we love you guys. God bless you.
Bye-bye.
Good night. Bye-bye. Okay. I'll see y'all later. Bye-bye.